Hi, good evening, everybody. Welcome. My name is Chris Wright. I'm the Managing Director of Infrastructure for Edmonton Public Schools. I'd like to thank you for making time coming out this evening. Chilly evening. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank Principal Rick Ramsey for hosting us this evening. Principal Ramsey, thank you very much for having us. Appreciate it. A couple quick introductions before we get going. I'd like to introduce and thank Deputy Premier, the Honorable Sarah Hoffman, for attending this evening. Thank you. Representing the Edmonton Public School Board trustees, Trustee Orville Chubb. Welcome, Trustee Chubb. Thank you. Our senior executive sponsor, the Executive Director of Infrastructure, Dr. Lauren Parker. Welcome, Dr. Parker. We're excited to be here this evening, and thank you very much, like I said, for joining us. It's an important step this evening in our journey towards leaving a legacy of excellent learning environments in every community, reinvesting, and being excited to walk with community as we have. Last spring, together with the City of Edmonton, we were out and we've to speak with you, and we've continued to collaborate and been striking working committees over the last year that Kim Holowaddick from our staff will talk about shortly. But it's very important. It's a journey that started, as I mentioned, a year ago. It's very important, and we're continuing to honor our commitment to walk with this community. And we look forward tonight to collecting your vision and your feedback and your thoughts and your reflections that will help inform moving forward our next steps. And so what I'd like to do is invite Ms. Kim Holowaddick from our staff up to walk you through a short presentation. And as she'll indicate, we have some opportunities to collect your feedback afterwards. So thank you, enjoy the evening. Appreciate your time. Kim.
Hello. I am very excited to be here this evening to share with you the work that has taken place since we were last here with you in the spring. I would like to start by acknowledging the members of our working committee, Rick, Nigel, Maureen, Lorna, Stephanie, DJ, Sharon, Jennifer, Leanne, Nancy, Susie, Tanis, and Corey. Thank you for your commitment and dedication to this project. Without the voices of your respective stakeholders, we would not have arrived where we are today. With a community-driven plan that once funded, will serve the students of the Britannia area long into the future. In addition, I would like to say thank you to district staff from Infrastructure and Communications for your assistance leading up to and including this evening. Last but not least, I will also extend my thanks to Principal Rick Ramsey and the Britannia staff and students for hosting and providing us with assistance this evening. All of the information that we shared with you last spring, the feedback we received, and the progress and materials accessed by the working committee are available online at spaceforstudents.epsb.ca. Tonight's presentation is being webcast, and the presentation slides will be available for viewing on the website in the next day or so. So don't worry if you miss something. An online feedback survey will also be made available after tonight's meeting. This has been our timeline to date. We came out to your community in March and May of last year to engage in conversations and collect your feedback. A working committee was established in October and completed their work in February. After tonight, we will once again use your feedback to inform recommendations to our Board of Trustees. Before I jump into the design concepts, I would like to remind you of the challenges our district is facing and why this type of consolidation plan is being considered. As we shared last spring, our district has been working on an infrastructure plan with the end goal of having all of our students, no matter where they live, receiving an excellent education in the best learning environment possible. The plan must also address the challenges our district is facing in terms of enrollment and aging buildings, and the costs not only to fix them or maintain them, but to provide the best learning spaces for our leaders of tomorrow. A reminder of a few key points to illustrate these challenges. Last year, we had almost 30,000 unused student spaces across the district. Unused equals unfunded. Yet, the space must be maintained. Last year, we opened 3 new schools, and in the fall, we will open 11 more. This will add another 10,000 spaces to our district. These new schools will provide local accommodation for students in some communities currently without a school. As students move out of their current schools and into the new spaces closer to home, the number of unused spaces in our mature communities will continue to grow. Again, unused equals unfunded. On an annual basis, the district spends approximately 25% more to operate and maintain space than is provided in funding. This money must come from somewhere, so it is often redirected away from the classroom and the instruction of students toward operational costs and general maintenance. So what do we mean when we talk about high-quality learning environments? We have spent a lot of time talking about this, both last spring and through our committee work. Research points to the fact that there is a correlation between student achievement and well-being and the environment in which they learn. The way students learn has changed over time, and we need to respond to those changes with learning environments that better support our learners. District schools are aging, and securing provincial funding to maintain and modernize all schools is challenging. We believe that modernizing or replacing schools is a reinvestment in mature communities. In some areas, the last public facility was built at least 30 years prior. This investment in public infrastructure in mature communities may even jumpstart additional reinvestment and renewal efforts. Adding to the underutilization is the issue of aging buildings. Right now, we have over 100 schools that have reached the end of their expected life cycle, and our deferred maintenance deficit continues to grow. In fact, this year, independent, detailed building assessments will be done on 153 of our buildings. This will give us a clear idea of the amount of our deferred maintenance deficit. We expect that it will be close to or exceed $1 billion. Provincial funding for modernizations and upgrades simply hasn't kept pace. As a reminder of how the cluster schools were selected, we began with an analysis of each of our planning sectors across the city, with a focus on enrollment and space utilization. This led us to the west and north central areas, as they have the lowest number of resident students and the highest number of unused spaces. Our infrastructure plan will address these issues in all of our mature communities in the city over the next few years. We grouped the schools according to junior high catchment areas so as not to disrupt feeder patterns and to keep families and communities whole. High schools were not included as they are being addressed through our high school accommodation plan, another branch of the larger infrastructure plan. For each cluster of schools, we looked at several things: the enrollment of each of the schools, the programs offered, and who is attending and where they reside. We first looked at the general facility condition of each school building. However, independent, detailed assessments were done on each of the cluster schools in April of last year. And lastly, we examined the current capacity of each of the schools according to the provincial model for measuring capacity, This is known as Instructional Area Model, or IAM, and the number of unused student spaces in each school. This last point is an interesting one, because when you walk into a school and look around, it may appear that all of the spaces are being used. Like our homes, there are spaces that are underutilized, like our formal living rooms or dining rooms and our spare bedrooms for occasional guests. These are nice to have, but there are costs associated with operating them. Funding for a school is determined by the number of students enrolled. So when we have fewer students, the money available to run and maintain the space is spread out further. Our Britannia cluster consists of four schools geographically located within a 400 hectare area: Brightview, Mayfield, and Youngstown Elementary, and Britannia Junior High School. We have been collaborating with the City of Edmonton to figure out how to best share information and to try to align our plans. As a slide, this is a very detailed map, but it shows some of the initiatives and future plans that the city has, such as transit routes, planned LRT routes, area redevelopment plans, as well as other parks and schools in the area. This map is available for viewing on our website. Independent value management studies were conducted by external architectural firms on each of our buildings in the Britannia cluster to better understand the condition of each facility and the cost to bring them up to proper standard and code. I want to note that district maintenance does an excellent job at maintaining the safety of our buildings for our students. These repairs would simply fix and replace components that are already in the schools. The repairs do not include additions, enhancements, or space reconfigurations that would create modern learning spaces for students. The schools would still be laid out and function like a school built in the 1950s. As mentioned previously, once feedback was collected last spring, a working committee was formed. Principals, parents, community members, and the City of Edmonton were invited to represent the voices of their respective stakeholders through this committee and to share back the information and experiences with all of you. The purpose of the working committee was to act as an advisory body in the development of school concepts for the Britannia area cluster. I must share with you, and will remind you throughout the evening, that this plan is very much at the conceptual stage, and there is currently no funding approval for construction. In the spring, we presented some initial concept ideas to you and collected your feedback. These concepts were intended as conversation starters, and your feedback was reviewed by and has shaped the work of the committee. The key themes that we pulled from your feedback were that you were open to exploring new grade configurations, safety of students on their way to school is important, and that you would like to see the Logos program expanded to junior high. The disruption and displacement of students during construction was identified as a concern. There were many other valuable pieces of feedback received, all of which have been taken into consideration. These were just the dominant ones. One of the things that we heard last spring was some apprehension about kindergarten to grade 9 model, or any model that may have a larger number of students or younger students mixed in with junior high age students. So what we did was go out and see a school in action and ask the questions that you posed to us. Here is a short video about one of our K-9 schools with enrollment of just over 900 students.
I think when you're going to have a K-9 school, it really does come down to making sure you have efficient systems in place. This is a really big school, it's true. But as we walk through the school, you'll see that we kind of have grouped students together. They have certain doors that they come in, they're in a comfortable spot, it's their area. Teachers can all work together. So down this hallway, we have about 5 classrooms all together, ones and twos only. You guys going to music? Your lineup looks so good. You can walk down our hallways at any point and never really get a sense of how many students we have in this building, because it's calm and it flows, and you know, students know how to move through the building in respectful ways.
We came the first year the school opened. I think it was 2010. I was nervous at first. Like, I admit that I was nervous. I was just scared of having smaller children with teenagers, preteens, because you always hear these bad things about preteens. But it's not true. They've turned out to be great. There is a strong sense of community. I think it's good because the smaller kids get used to the bigger crowds, and then when you go to high school, which is even double the size of this school, it's not such a shock.
Oh, we do have some buddies going on here too. So in our school, we have all of our classrooms, our younger classrooms, paired with older classrooms. So relationships are formed, and in fact, we see these relationships continue over the years. So you can see over time that our kids have lots of older mentors throughout the building, and you can see the excitement, right? That they're really enjoying reading with their buddies. We're on the second floor now, and on the second floor is where most of our junior high classes take place. So developmentally, they're at that age that they're, you know, trying out some new things and new looks and new words even sometimes. What I'm noticing specifically the difference with our junior high students is they really do see themselves as mentors, and the fact that they have to model good behavior. That is one of the biggest differences I saw when I came here to the school. How our junior high, it's softer in terms of how they are engaging with each other and then engaging with others. I love it. We actually have some students who've actually volunteered to help outside during their lunch break. So we've given them the supervisor vests to put on, and they go out and they play with the kids, and they love doing it. And the kids look forward to having these grade 9 boys out there playing with them, right? So they've made those connections.
I went to a school in Ontario, and I got picked on a lot. Didn't really get like that much of a role model from the older kids. So I like the idea that we get to be the role model to all of them, and just to understand that they look up to the people we are.
Don't be intimidated by junior highs.
Like we usually do.
Because we're nice.
And those relationships are so delightful to see. I've seen little kinders pointing to their parents with them. That's my friend, you know, pointing to a big kid in grade 9. It's just, it's awesome to see. It really is.
We toured each school through the eyes of the independent value management studies conducted last spring. On the screen, you will see some of the photos taken on each of the tours. For a full look at each of the schools and to review the value management studies, you can go to our Space for Students website. Going from left to right, we see a typical classroom at Britannia, a washroom at Brightview, wired glass windows at Mayfield, and evidence of foundation issues at Youngstown. In order to gain an understanding of the possibilities available in a new construction project compared to the possibilities and/or limitations of modernizing an existing building, we toured a newer school and a school of similar age to the ones in our cluster that had undergone a major modernization. Both schools hosted kindergarten through grade 9, so we also got to see how students in a K-9 environment might be organized within a building. Slideshows of these tours are also available for viewing on our website. In addition to the data shared last spring, the committee looked at several other pieces, including municipal census and other data provided to us by the City of Edmonton. This slide shows the utilization rate at each school as determined using the provincial model. Adjusted enrollment takes into consideration the special needs of some students and the fact that more program space is required to meet their education needs. For example, a student with severe special needs is counted as three. This is particularly evident at Mainfield School, which serves as a hub for pre-kindergarten programming. It also takes into consideration that kindergarten students attend only half a day and are counted as 0.5. You can see this reflected in the adjusted enrollment for Youngstown School. We looked at several pieces of data that painted a picture of enrollment in the area over time. As you can see here, enrollment in each of the schools has declined over time and is now relatively stable. Fluctuations in enrollment can be attributed to factors such as program establishment or deactivation, or accommodation of students from developing neighborhoods while awaiting a school in their area. Youngstown, for example, has been serving students from the Secord neighborhood west of Winterburn Road. King School opened for September 2017, meaning enrollment will once again drop at Youngstown School as students leave to attend their local school. We also examined data that showed us how many students come into the area for programming, how many stay and attend their local school, and how many students leave the area to access programming elsewhere. As you can see, we have a large number of students that leave the Britannia area, many for alternative programs, but almost 300 are leaving simply to attend a regular program somewhere else, many for junior high. The committee considered this information in developing concepts that included alternate grade configurations in an effort to keep kids in the area. This is a scatter map showing where Edmonton Public School students in the Britannia Cluster area live. The red area shows the highest concentration of students to be in the Britannia Youngstown neighborhood, followed by Kenora, Mayfield, and High Park. Where students live was an important factor considered in the selection of sites for the concepts that I will be sharing. After reviewing data, the committee focused on four questions. How many students do we need to serve? What size of schools and grade configurations will be best for our students? Which school sites should be considered? What basic things should an architect consider in developing concepts? In order to determine the number of students we need to serve, we use the first calculation that looks at the number of resident students and the percentage of students that attend their designated school. In mature areas, only about 60% of students attend their local school. Add to that the number of students that come into the area for programming, and we have the number of students we need to serve. In the second calculation, we used a higher rate of retention, more in line with what we see in areas with new schools. We would expect that with the proposed concepts, more students would stay in the area to attend school. All of the school concepts I will share also take into consideration potential future growth by providing designs that can be expanded or contracted to meet the population. Once we had considered number of students, grade configurations, and size of schools, we had to determine which existing sites could best accommodate new construction or modernization and addition. We put out a survey asking for feedback on the most important things to consider when selecting a school site. Thank you to everyone who participated. Feedback told us that a site that allows for the most green space is desirable and that student safety was a priority, meaning that the school can be located away from traffic and busy streets and that students are safe during construction. Earlier feedback told us that it was also preferable not to disrupt students during construction if possible. The other considerations are ranked in the order of importance as indicated by your feedback. The committee examined each site through this lens and determined that not all sites were suitable, particularly for new construction. Three preliminary site layout designs were reviewed by the committee. Feedback led to the creation of a fourth concept. All concepts include the consolidation of students from Britannia, Brightview, Mayfield, and Youngstown schools. A formal closure process would follow funding approval of this project, but students would remain in their current schools until new or modernized spaces are ready to welcome students. Before I begin sharing the concepts, I will remind you that these visuals will be available on our website and in your breakout rooms later on. Concept 1 combines students into a pre-K to grade 3 school on the Youngstown site and a grades 4-9 school on the Britannia site. The new pre-K to grade 3 school on the Youngstown school site would face north with parking and drop-off areas coming off 104th Avenue. Once complete, the current school would be demolished and replaced with field space. The layout and type of fields are only suggestions. Work with the City of Edmonton to address school and community needs would be part of the detailed design process. I want to remind you that these designs are very much at the conceptual stage, and a final design process would more closely address the needed program space within the school. Here are a couple of other images that show what the school might look like on the Youngstown site. Much green space is preserved, and moving the entrance off the busy 163rd Street provides increased safety for students. Students would be able to remain in the current school building during construction. This concept honors much of the feedback you provided to us in the spring. The second part of this concept is the construction of a new grades 4-9 school on the Britannia site. As the new building sits on top of a portion of the current school, it is unclear at this time whether students would be able to remain in part of the building during construction. The committee felt that the disruption of students in this concept would be minimal, as the enrollment at Britannia is low and junior high age students are better able to manage displacement to another school. The Britannia site is large enough to allow for the necessary parking and drop-off areas. However, some of the green space is lost. The committee felt that the proximity of the two schools would be beneficial for families, as it would allow for older siblings to drop off younger ones before moving on to their own schools. The second concept suggests modernizing and constructing an addition at Mayfield School to serve students in pre-K to grade 3 and a new grades 4-9 school on the Britannia site. This concept honors the feedback that suggested keeping a school north of 107th Avenue. The modernization of Mayfield School would change the footprint by adding additional classroom space. The interior layout of the school would not change very much, other than enlarging the classrooms to meet current standards. The committee asked the architect to explore the possibility of connecting the second floor of the main building to the 1962 addition, but this was determined to not be feasible. The pre-K program requires a higher staff component than a regular school, so you can see the additional parking added to this concept. The current parking area behind the school would become a hard surface play area, and parking would be positioned along the laneway to the southwest. This will provide safety for students by ensuring that they are not crossing the parking areas to access play spaces. A drop-off lane for buses beside the new addition would be included, as well as a turnaround. The second part of Concept 2 is a new grades 4-9 school on the Britannia site. This design is exactly the same as the school proposed in Concept 1. The building to the west of the school is the Boys and Girls Club. The committee felt that this may present some unique and beneficial partnership opportunities. Concept 3 contemplates a one-school model, a pre-K to grade 9, two-level school on the Youngstown site. The committee felt that there were many benefits in a K-9 model after exploring other K-9 schools in the district. Originally, the committee asked the architects to explore a campus model with two buildings on one site. The designs that came back would have left little to no green space, so the committee asked for one school building. The school on the Youngstown site would again be oriented toward 104th Avenue, improving the safety of students by moving away from 163rd Street. After exploring other K-9 schools, the committee felt that the two-level design would allow for different zones to be established within the school to accommodate the different grade levels. This concept would allow students to remain in their current schools until the new school was able to open its doors to all students. The fourth concept takes the previous pre-K to 9 design and places it on the Britannia site. As you can see, the school would need to be set back further on the site to accommodate the necessary parking and drop-off areas. These renderings give a better sense of how the two-level school would be positioned on the site. Once again, I will remind you that these are conceptual designs and that feedback received will help to inform any final designs. In all of the designs, we asked the architect to include potential partnership space within the design. These spaces would be unfunded and would require a partner to provide the capital funds to build. If such a partner did not come forward, the space would not be built, and the final design would be tweaked so as not to disrupt the overall aesthetic. This does not mean that future partnership space cannot be added. A final design would include service connections so that if a future partner was identified, additional construction would be possible. Those are all of the concepts that we have to share with you tonight. All of the concept designs will be made available for viewing on our Space for Students website and in your breakout rooms following this presentation. We will be collecting feedback tonight and through our online survey until March 29th, after which it will be reviewed and a recommendation of a preferred concept will be prepared and presented to our Board of Trustees for consideration in our three-year capital plan. Placeholders for each of the three cluster communities have been included for trustee consideration already. Should the province approve funding for this project, a formal closure process would take place. Where possible, students would remain in their current schools until the new spaces were ready to accept students. A separate process of engagement would take place around the future of closed buildings. In terms of time, it's difficult to say. If funding were announced tomorrow, it would take about a year for the design process, an additional 18 months to 2 years for construction. We are committed to keeping the community engaged and updated on any decisions to be made in the future, so stay tuned. We invite you now to take part in a facilitated small group discussion to identify what you see as the strengths and challenges of each concept. Participation in the breakout sessions is optional, so if you do not wish to stay, please visit our website and survey to provide your feedback. Your voice is important. When you arrived, you received a handout with a map of the school on it. On the map, one classroom has been highlighted. At the end of this presentation, please go directly to the room assigned. Each room has been assigned a facilitator. These facilitators are principals and other district leadership staff. Each room will have a note taker to capture your thoughts, feelings, and ideas for our records. In order to allow for an even distribution of people in each room, please attend in the room assigned. Student leaders are on hand to provide assistance in finding your rooms. All of the rooms are on the second floor, so if you require the use of an elevator, please see one of the student leaders for assistance. More information regarding the concepts and the data mentioned previously will be available to you in the breakout rooms. In addition, staff from infrastructure and members of the working committee will circulate the rooms throughout the evening to answer questions. Once again, thank you for being here this evening.